Okay.
What's your mother's maiden name? Huh? Mother's maiden name.
The movie begins by introducing us to a man named Chris, a now retired tech whiz who made it big with various apps, software, and an impressive home security system. He's receiving a call from his now soon-to-be ex-wife Jamie, as she's discussing the final signing of the papers with him. He clearly doesn't want to move on from this relationship, explaining his reluctance to sign the papers, but she tells him that it's now time to move on, and he finally starts to accept it. And rather luckily for him, or unluckily depending on how you look at things, later that night, with the added advantage of there being less people around, Chris decides to head to the store to pick up some ice cream, where he has what feels like a chance run-in with a woman named Sky as she asks him for some help with choosing a bottle of wine. But instead, he whips out his phone to tell her about this video's sponsor, Raid Shadow Legends. Explore millions of champion combinations and master countless tactics as you take on raid bosses, dungeon runs, campaign battles, and PvP arena matches, all from the comfort of your mobile or desktop device. When I've been playing recently, I've been checking out the champions, Cephalia and Ursula the Mourner. Cephalia is a great support champion, useful basically all of the time, but especially in PvP, thanks to her many turn meter manipulation skills. Her A2 is an incredibly powerful heal, able to bring entire teams back from the brink of defeat, and her A3 strips off enemy buffs, letting you take down those Fortress Arena teams. Ursula the Mourner, using her A2, cripples the enemy attackers and boosts your own, with paired decreased attack and increased attack buffs. Her A3 revives your whole team and makes them tough as bricks, with strengthened and increased defense. Raid suits me best when I've got a little bit of downtime between doing things, taking a break from working, waiting for the kettle to boil, or when I just fancy a go at it. And the nature of the game allows for that. There's a ton happening in Raid this month, with some new champions, an update to Tag Arena, and a full schedule of special events and tournaments. But here's the main event. Raid's currently running a special Deliana Chase event, where you can get your hands on the amazing Deliana, a brand new legendary champion from the High Elves faction, gained simply just by logging in. All you have to do is log in and play Raid for 7 days, between now and July the 20th, and you'll get the champion for free. That's it. They're one of the strongest support champions in the entire game, and can help carry your team past many of Raid's tougher challenges. You don't want to miss her. Hit the link in the description to get started with Raid, and you'll get a free champion, Misericord, Tiger Soul, and Romero, 10 Magic XP Brew, 10 Force XP Brew, and 10 Spirit XP Brew. For new players, once you're in the game, just enter promo code MYDELIANA to get your hands on everything. 50 XP Brews to max your legendary hero Deliana to level 50, as well as a ton of silver. And once you're in game, you can find me under the name Big Will, and if you're fast, you can join my clan. Chris offers her a ride back to the motel that she's sharing with her roommate Lisa, but after getting there and staring at the front door, she'd really rather not go in due to an argument between the pair some hours before. So Chris, being nice and sensing some chemistry with her, invites her back to his house for a few hours as they wait for Lisa to fall asleep. They crack open a bottle of wine before cracking open a substantially more expensive bottle of wine, as Chris admits he's actually got a bit of a thing for collecting wine. And after the pair share a few more drinks together, the chemistry that Chris sensed earlier blossoms into something a little bit more as Sky ends up staying the night with the pair sleeping together. The next day, we see Sky return to the motel and appears to be completely unbothered by the sight of Lisa being visibly upset due to her neither returning home or calling her last night. Upset in a way that would seem to suggest that there's a little bit more to their relationship than just friendship. The previous night, Sky had told Chris about a cocktail bar that she's currently working at, and as she left in the morning, leaving him with no way to contact her, he decides to head over there to pay her a visit. And when he does, she's visibly happy to see him there, and once she finishes her shift, the pair walk back to his car together. But as they do, they spot a man attempting to break into it. Chris begins to try and de-escalate the situation, followed by Sky throwing a bottle at the man, admittedly doing more damage to the car than the man, causing the thief to respond by approaching and hitting Chris in the knee until it breaks. After a visit to the hospital, the next morning, Chris is being wheeled back into his house with a cast around his leg and clearly in need of some help. His intentions are to use a private nursing system to have someone to come over and take care of him, but Sky, suggesting that she feels bad for being responsible for all of this happening, tells him that she'd rather do the job of the nurse instead. And with Chris feeling like their relationship so far has been nothing but love at first sight, agrees to let let this random stranger who he's just met move in with him to make sure he's okay. He went out to buy some ice cream, but brought home a stray woman instead. With Sky now having access to all of Chris's security codes, she heads back to the motel and immediately begins packing, followed by her then proceeding to kiss Lisa at the first sight of upset, before returning to Chris and proceeding to do the exact same thing. It's one of the first signs that something isn't quite right with this whole situation. At a glance, it looks as if Sky is playing people. She gets romantically involved with them in order to gain something, and once she's found something better, she's moving on. The shadiness evolves into outright criminality, as the next day when Lisa's landlord Ron comes over looking for the unpaid rent, he lets himself in after repeatedly knocking on the door and calling out to her, and then finds her dead in the bathtub with her wrists mysteriously cut. The police question Ron about Lisa's now missing girlfriend, and they confirm to both him and the viewers that Sky isn't a real person. It's a fake identity, and they have no record of her even existing. Chris suddenly decides that it's probably a good idea to try and learn something about this random stranger who he's just given full control of his house to, and when she's in the shower, decides to have a little snoop around, finding a reel of pictures of both Sky and Lisa before being caught red-handed. Sky doesn't seem to be bothered that he's snooping around her things and doesn't really have that much of a strange reaction. But a strange thing that she does do, rather ominously later that night, the woman who apparently doesn't even exist lays down in Chris's daughter's room and proceeds to sing a song about kids going to heaven. You know, like a normal person. The next morning, Chris wakes up, fully expecting his new girlfriend Sky to be lying in the bed next to him. But not only is she absent, but so is his phone. And after realizing that the tablet in the kitchen isn't working either, he sees a news broadcast reporting on the death of a local woman named Lisa. The exact same person that Chris had just seen in the photos with Sky. Sky then suddenly returns back to the house with a bucket of fried chicken, because it's never a bad time for fried chicken, and upon being told about the death of her friend, she doesn't skip a beat and continues to eat as if Chris has just told her the weather forecast for the day, leaving Chris visibly shaken and uncertain what to think, considering that Sky seems to be in good spirits about it, kind of contradicting the whole dead friend thing. And after a little more prodding by Chris, she simply tells him plain as day, yeah, she knows Lisa's dead because she's the one who killed her. There's a reason that Sky didn't seem to mind Chris finding the photos of the pair, despite her knowing that he'll put the connection together. Chris isn't going to live long enough for it to become an issue. He attempts to make his way out of the house, but with Sky in full control of the property and Chris without a phone, with a tap of a button, she locks him inside with her. The only reason that Sky had been living with Lisa in the first place, because it allowed for the perfect opportunity for her to spy on Chris using a telescope, and that Lisa had to die because her jealousy issues and tendency to be nosy would have just gotten in the way. Sky was able to seduce this woman, cause her to fall madly in love with her, and to care deeply about her, but once Sky was done with her, she disposed of Lisa as if she was nothing more than a piece of trash ready for the landfill. The last 2 months have been spent religiously and meticulously watching Chris in order to understand everything about his life, even down to the most minute of details. And the way that she explains it all to him leads the viewer to think that this clearly isn't her first time doing it. Everything was planned out, it happened exactly the way that she intended it to. And after he tries to take control of the situation, she uses a taser to take him to the ground before using it to render him unconscious. Back at the motel, Ron's going through Lisa's apartment, under the guise of cleaning, but with the real intention of snooping, and ends up coming across the telescope in Sky's room. And Ron, being Ron, immediately turns it away from Chris's house and uses it to perv on the neighbors. And after he's, done, Ron eventually returns it back to its original position to then get a clear view of Sky. With Chris tied to a wheelchair, she tells him that she's doing this to him because he's rich and kicks him onto his back as he's completely helpless to save himself. She likes what Chris has got, and she wants it for herself. After he refuses to give up his passwords and personal information, she retrieves a drill and drills it directly through his cast and repeatedly into his already broken leg, making it more broken, I guess. Despite Chris's strong resolve, she's eventually given access to his bank account and proceeds to drain it of everything that it has. But that's not good enough for her. That was just the easy part. Next on her list of things to do is to have him make some calls and liquidate all of his stock to fund her new company. But as she cuts his hand free to prepare him for a Zoom call, he immediately wraps it around her neck and the pair are taken to the floor. So in response, she reaches for a pair of scissors, thrusts them into his shoulder, and shows him a video of his daughter Willow and his ex-wife Jamie, who he still clearly very much loves. And as Chris knows all too well, Sky is more than prepared to end someone for simply the suggestion of them getting in the way. If this amount of money money was on the line, then there's no reason to believe that she'd even hesitate to do it. She proceeds to not only take all of his expensive devices and art to sell, but the very same man who broke his leg to begin with arrives at the house with a truck with the intention of taking all of the furniture, the expensive wine collection, and even the rugs. They truly are stripping Chris of everything that he has, with his life more than likely belonging to that list of things too. Ron, for some reason, doesn't immediately call the police, but instead sneaks his way up to the house after waiting for Sky and the other men to leave. He might not be as bad as Sky and her associates, but he's no angel himself. He sees an opportunity in front of him, and he's going to take it at whatever cost. He breaks into the house, alerting Sky in the process, and tells Chris that he wants to be paid handsomely for saving him, with no real rush, to get to the part that involves saving the incredibly injured man. He sets his eyes upon a supposed Picasso painting left behind, and as he starts to free Chris, Sky returns. He grabs himself a kitchen knife for defense, but she one-ups him by pulling out a sword previously used for decoration in the house. She locks the house down, and with Chris still restrained, Ron makes a run for it. As Sky is distracted, clearly enjoying the hunt of her previous landlord, Chris manages to break free from the restraints and find an unlocked ski-mobile on the property. In the meantime, Sky's found Ron hiding in the garage, and with a big smile across her face, knocks him to the ground and repeatedly plunges the sword into him. Like a lot. Adrenaline and fear pumping through Chris's body, he hits something and is sent flying from the snowmobile and directly into the road as he's almost run over by a car. The driver sits him in the car, dials 911, and hands Chris the phone. But by the time Chris realizes who he's actually talking to, the driver has taken him right back up to the house and knocks him unconscious. As Chris begins to come to, once again being wheeled into his home, this time under a set of incredibly different circumstances, the pair kiss, and the man tells Chris that he's her stepfather. Talk about daddy issues. Sky's mother died, quote, unexpectedly, and the man took her under his wing and began to train her in the art of draining people for all they've got. And their justification for targeting Chris? Well, because he wasn't using any of it. Basically because he's an introvert that likes to buy ice cream at midnight. The next night, Chris is forced to stare blankly out of the window into the pitch black darkness with no other choice but to listen, as Sky and her stepfather have a totally normal and definitely not really weird and kind of creepy relationship in the other room. Yeah, it's probably not a great idea to have your DNA all over your crime scene, and the only reason that Chris is still alive at this point is because he has more. They know that in a safe deposit box protected by a biometric scanner in the bank lies $14 million worth in bearer bonds, and they want them too. Wow, they really are ruthless. They'll take $14 million from him and still take his iPad. So to get past the biometric scanner, they cut off his thumb. Seems reasonable. The next day, as a surprise to Sky and her stepfather, Willow and Jamie show up at Chris's house and walk in to see broken glass and all of the furniture gone, before then being confronted by Sky and her stepfather. They lock the pair in a closet with a badly beaten Chris, retrieve the thumb that they've frozen, and head off to the bank. With the pair gone, and Chris realizing that he'll be of no use to them soon, and understanding what that means for him and the other people around him, convinces Jamie to allow Willow to climb up into the air vents and to unlock the door from the outside. The sense of urgency sets in even harder, as when Chris discloses their plan to Jamie, she reveals that the bonds aren't even there, meaning that the pair are going to come back with a vengeance. Her lawyer instructed her to take them during the divorce because it would give her leverage against Chris in case he tried to screw her. They make it back to the house to find the closet empty, but when the stepfather opens a different door, he's attacked by Chris with an ice pick. After being sliced, he takes it from Chris with ease, knocks him to the ground, and Sky enters the room with a gun. But as the stepfather is repeatedly shouting at her, telling her to hurry up and just shoot him already, she turns the gun on him and fires into his chest, killing him. Because, daddy issues, I guess? Giving Chris the opportunity to plant the ice pick into her shoulder, take the phone, and leave the gun there for some reason. He sends out an SOS to emergency services and begins using his phone to mess with Sky by turning out the light, enabling the thermal camera, and turning on and off various different electrical devices throughout the house. Eventually, he does get the drop on her and tackles her to the ground, and as she's slicing at him, Jamie then runs into the room. The pair fight back and forth, with Jamie getting stabbed in the leg, and as Sky is about to kill Chris, Willow enters the room from behind and shoots her in the back. Well, that's one way to ruin your child. And the movie then comes to an end, with one incredibly traumatized child with a lifetime of intense therapy aimed at tackling her intense childhood trauma. Before the video comes to an end, I just want to say a big thank you for watching, and if you're interested in upcoming projects, then click the link in the description and follow me on Twitter. And before we finish for good, I just want to give a big shout out to my patrons. Thank you to Dom, Hunters263, Rebecca Pitt, A Dandy in Space, Martin Brannan, Natasha Twyman, Jared C. Bees, Pascal Mathis, Fighting the Pirates, Richard McGowan III, Macy J, Rhys Harford, Horatio, Rami Patterson, Chris, Michelle, Newcomb, Dennis, Wade Knott, Ike, Ashley L. Wintz, Austin Wypert, Christopher Butsky, Joshua Torres, Biddy Kyle, Remy, Fire Goes Fast, Josh Brooks, and Ash Kamahara. Thank you so much to my patrons, and thank you to everyone else for watching.